in keeping with our tradition, on these special days, I take a break from giving a regular kind of Dhamma talk, and I tell stories from the, usually from the Jatakas. And I picked out four rather short stories that are all on a theme. They all involve a sea voyage and a shipwreck. Now, it seems to me that from what I've read in the stories, that the ancient Indians of the Buddha's time were not very good mariners, because almost all the stories of sea voyages end in a shipwreck. I think later they became more of a seagoing people in the later times, colonizing Southeast Asia and so on. But in the Buddhist time, their own knowledge of geography was very limited outside of India. Jampadvipa was, India was the southern continent, was basically the world, and foreign countries were all considered to be minor islands. Even if they were just other points on the mainland of Asia, they were still, to the Indian mind, they were just minor islands. And I need better light to see my notes. Okay, so the first one that I picked out is the Suparaka Jataka, and it involves a mariner of Barukacha, which is a city on the east coast of India, and most of the sea voyages that are involved in these stories start out from that point, because a lot of the what trade they did have was with Southeast Asia and Burma and what they call Suvarnabhumi, Southeast Asia, the Golden Land. It was a place of great treasure and wonder that they would seek their fortune. And this was a mariner of Barukacha who was reputed to be, his name was Suparaka, and he was reputed to be very wise and highly knowledgeable about the ways of sailing and ships and the seven seas. But after many years of sailing in the oceans, the gradual effect of salt water in his eyes made him blind. So he became landbound. And the king hired him as an appraiser, thinking that, you know, this is blind or not, he's a very wise person. So his first test was somebody had brought an elephant for the royal service. He wanted to sell it to the king for the royal service, and he asked this Suparaka to check the elephant out. And Suparaka felt it all over with his hands and said, "This elephant's no good. When it was a baby, his mother picked it up once and dropped it and injured its hind legs, and it's never recovered properly." And it turned out to be true. So the king gave him a reward. He gave him 8 pieces of silver. And then the next test was they brought a horse that they were going to sell for the king's service. And he checked out the horse and he said, "This horse is poorly developed and short of wind. Its mother must have died before it was properly weaned, and it didn't grow right." And that turned out to be true. So he got another 8 pieces of silver. Then somebody brought a chariot, and he checked it over and said, "The axle's made from a rotten piece of wood. This is no good." And again, the same thing, and 8 pieces of silver. And then they brought a rug for the royal palace, and he checked it over and said, "There's a couple of small holes. The rats have chewed in it." And so again, he was given 8 pieces of silver. But by this time, he was disgusted. He said, "For all my good work, the king's just given me 8 pieces of silver at a time. This is a barber's wage. I'm worth more than that." He quit the royal service, and he went back to the port. And some sailors were getting a ship ready to go to sea, but their skipper had gone missing, and they didn't have a skipper. And they said, "Well, there's old Suparaka. He's the wisest man, knows everything about the ships and the sea. We should take him on board as skipper." And he said, "I can't do that. I'm blind." They said, we don't mind. You've got such a good reputation. You'll manage blind or not. So he agreed to be their skipper. And they set out to sea, heading for the Golden Land, Suwannabumi. And when they were partway there, a terrible storm blew up. Great huge waves, and the sky was black, and thunder and lightning, and belting rain, and high winds, and the sails were getting shredded, and the whole ship was shaking and quaking. And when they had blown so far off course, when the storm abated, they were in strange seas that none of the sailors on board knew where they were, except Suparika. He asked them to describe what they saw in the sea, and they said, "We see these strange creatures jumping in and out of the water. They have bodies like men and heads like fish with sharp beaks." And he said, "Oh, they're very dangerous. We mustn't go in the water. This is the Kuramala, the Razor Sea." And he knew that the ocean there was full of diamonds, but he refrained from telling the men because he was afraid in their greed they would leap overboard to get the diamonds. Instead, he ordered a fishing net to be cast out with heavy weights at the bottom so that it would sink low and to the bottom, and they pulled it up full of diamonds. And he told them to throw out all the cargo we brought from India, throw it in the sea, it's worthless, we'll just keep these diamonds. And they kept sailing as best they could, and they came to another place where the water looked like it was on fire. It was glowing red and flickering. And they asked him, what is this? And he says, "This is the Agimala, the fire sea." And he had them again drop the nets, and they came up with gold, and they loaded that into the hold as well. And then they came to the Dadimala, which is a sea that had the appearance of milk. It was a white, frothy sea. And when they dropped the nets, they pulled up hunks of silver. Then they came to the Kusamala, the grassy sea. The whole sea was a bright green color. And when they threw in the nets, they pulled up emeralds. And they came to the Nalamala, which was the Red Sea. The whole sea was a bright red color. And when they dropped the nets, they pulled up lapis lazuli. So their hold was filled with treasure, but then they come across a very terrible Wal Abu Makas Sea, where the sea was sunk down in the middle like a saucer, and at the edges of this wide circular area, the waves were rising up, and it was like a gigantic whirlpool, and they were being sucked into it, and they see no way of escaping. But Suparaka had lived a righteous life. He was the Bodhisatta, and he lived a righteous life, and by the power of his parami of truth, he was able to get them out. And this is something that occurs in several of the Jataka stories and the Dhammapada stories. You call it an asseveration of truth. If some being is highly developed spiritually, then he makes an asseveration of truth. Then he can work supernormal power. And so he did the ritual preparations, and then he made the asseveration. "For as long as I can remember, since I was come to my manhood, I have never killed a living being. And by the power of this asseveration of truth, may this ship be saved." And the ship immediately got free of the power of the whirlpool, and they sailed back to India at a wondrous pace and reached India in a single day. And they were all wealthy for the rest of their lives from all the treasure in the hold of the ship. So I guess that wasn't actually a shipwreck. It was a close call. With the other stories involve shipwrecks. The next one is the Susandhi Jataka. And this is one of the jatakas where the bodhisattva doesn't actually act in completely moral fashion. And this is something that's been pointed out by commentators on the jataka, studying the jatakas, that in the course of the whole collection, the bodhisattva breaks all the precepts except the one against telling an untruth. He never tells an untruth, but he breaks all the other precepts at one time or another in the jatakas. And this particular one, the bodhisattva came back as a supana. These giant birds, also called garudas, like these giant magical birds that attack and eat nagas, the serpent beings. And they have the power of transformation. They're like the nagas in this way. They can transform themselves into human shape and pass as human and mingle amongst human beings undetected. And this particular naga, he lived on an island, the island of Saruma. And he used to like to go to Jambudvipa, to India, to visit a king, King Tamba, that he was friendly with, and play at dice with him. He was fond of gambling. And the two of them would spend hours playing at dice. And King Tamba had his chief queen was named Susandhi, and she was very beautiful but kind of frivolous in her and vain in her ways. And one time, one of the serving girls that was who brought some wine or some food to the men playing dice, and then she went in the back when the women's chambers, and she talked to the queen Susandhi and said, "Oh, you should see that fellow who's playing dice with your king. He's such a good-looking man. He's so handsome. I can't believe it." And so Susandhi became piqued of curiosity. So she made some excuse to come into the gaming room, and she had one look at this fellow playing dice, who was actually the supana, who had taken on the form of a very beautiful young human Brahmin, and she immediately fell in love with him. And he looked at her, and they exchanged a glance, and all was known, and they both wanted each other. So the supana used his magical powers. They have powers over these giant birds. They have powers over the weather. So he caused a huge storm to rise up, and the sky went black as pitch. And in the darkness, he snuck out with this queen and escaped with her back to his island and hid her there. And his place where he abode was by this really large, beautiful banyan tree. And he had an abode there, and he set her up in luxury there, and they were passionate lovers. And he would still go back and play dice with the king from time to time. And the king had no idea what had happened to his queen. Where did my queen go? And the king had a minstrel named Saga. And he was a very trusted boon companion of the king. And he asked Saga one time, "Saga, would you take on the job of searching for Queen Susandhi? I think something has happened to her. She's completely disappeared, and no one knows where she went." So Saga said he would do that, and he set out on the roads making inquiries and looking here and there, and no one had heard or seen anything of the queen. And in the course of his wanderings, he found his way to Barakacha on the coast, and he took up with some sailors there, and he thought, "I can't find her anywhere in Jambudvipa. Maybe I'll have better luck at overseas." And he told the sailors, "Look, I'm a minstrel, and I'm very well liked for my talents of singing and playing the lute. If you'll take me on board your ship for free and carry me, I'll entertain the crew." So they agreed to that, and they took him on board. And when they were well out at sea, they asked him once to play his lute and sing, and he said, I better not do that right now. We're coming into a sea full of dangerous fish. And if I start singing and playing the lute, the fish will start leaping about and dancing, and there could be so much damage to the ship that could sink. And they just laughed at it and said, "That's not going to happen." And so they kind of badgered him into putting on a performance. So he strung his, tuned up his lute and started singing. And just as he predicted, the fish started leaping about, and they were buffeting the sides of the ship. And then a gigantic sea monster, one of these giant fish that live deep in the ocean that are a hazard to mariners in the deep ocean, came leaping out of the sea and landed flat amidships, and the ship sunk immediately. Saga, clinging to a plank, he survived. He was the only one that survived, and he came washed up on the shore, as it would have it. He washed up on the shore of the island where the queen was living. And the Supana had left. He had gone to play dice, and the queen was there alone. And he was half dead from seawater. She helped him ashore and nursed him back to life, and then she fancied him as well. And so they became lovers, and he would hide in the forest whenever the Supana came home. And this went on for some months, and then a ship pulled in of traders from Benares, and he got his way onto the ship and went back to India. And he didn't say a word to the king about what had happened, but the next time the Supana came to play dice, the minstrel stood singing a song, and he cleverly worded the song about a big banyan tree on an island and a beautiful princess, and who knows who is her lover now. And the Supana took the hint of this song, and he brought the queen back to the king and left her and never came back to that place again. So what do I need this woman for? This next one is the Sankha Jataka, and this story, I believe, is meant to have occurred in a previous world age, because it starts out by saying that the story takes place in the city of Mohalini, which was what Benares was called at that time. And usually, I think that means like a different world age. So, what we call Benares was, or Pali is actually Varanasi. They called at that time Mohalini. And there was a Brahmin Sankha named Sankha there, who was very wealthy, and he was also very generous. He had built an alms hall where any persons, wanderers or homeless people, could come and feed at his expense. And he kept this up for several years, and he saw that his treasure was running out. And he said, "I'd better make some more treasure. So I think I'll take what money I've got left and buy trade goods with it and go to Suvarnabhumi and make my fortune again." So he set out on the road to the coast, and a Pacheka Buddha up in the Himawan, one of the Pacheka Buddhas, with his psychic power, he saw that this fellow, who was the Bodhisattva, was heading towards the coast with the intention of going to Suvarnabhumi, and he knew by his psychic power that he would come into misfortune. And he wanted to help him, save him in some way as he could. So he said, I'll give him an opportunity to make merit." And with his psychic power, he flew down from the scented mountain in the Himavant, where the Pacheka Buddhas lived. He flew down to the lands of men and started walking down the road. And it was a very hot day. It was in the hot season, and the road was painful to walk on. It was like burning sand, and the sun was beating down. And Sankha saw this wanderer, this Samana wandering down the road with no shoes and no hat, and he said, "This won't do." And he invited the holy man to sit under a shady tree. And he took off his own sandals and he cleaned them and he oiled them and he gave them to the Pacheka Buddha. And he gave the Pacheka Buddha his parasol. And he said, "Now you can be protected from the sun, dear sir." And then Pacheka Buddha thanked him very kindly and carried on his way and then rose up into the air and flew back to the scented mountain. And Sankha saw him rise up into the air and he knew that was a Pacheka Buddha. "I have made great merit today." And he got on board the ship with his trade goods and booked passage to trade in Suvarnabhumi. But as it happened, the ship encountered a bad storm on the way, and the planks opened up, and the ship broke and sunk. And everyone was drowned except Sankha, who was very strong and athletic. And he had, before he, when he saw the ship was starting to go down, he covered his body in ghee and dove into the water and started swimming in the direction that he thought would be land. And he swam for 7 days. And as it happens, there was a devi, a female dewa named Manimakkala, who had been charged by the four great kings that her task was to survey the seas to see if any righteous beings are in danger of shipwreck and drowning, and to save them. But she was a kind of a frivolous thing, and she liked to enjoy her dewa parties and games. And for 7 days she neglected watching the sea. And then finally she thought, "I better have a check and see what's going on in the ocean." And she saw this poor fellow swimming for his life in the middle of the sea. And so she immediately flew down there to hover in the air over him. And she materialized a platter full of delicious food and offered it to him. But Sankha was a very righteous person, and this happened to be the day of the Upasana fast, and he had taken a vow to keep the Upasana fast. So he refused the food, even though he'd been 7 days without food and swimming and on the verge of death. He still refused to take the food. So she was impressed by his piety, and she said, "Well, what can I do for you?" And he said, "Well, you can get me back to India. That would be nice." So she said, "Well, what kind of vehicle would do that?" He said, "Well, a ship." So she materialized a magical ship that all the fittings were made out of gold and jewels and lapis lazuli and all these kind of diamonds, and this kind of miraculous magical ship. And he got on board, and it, under its own power, it sped back to India in a single day and took him upriver all the way to Malini or Benares. And he was able to sell the various jeweled fittings from the ship and live comfortably off that and give alms and make merit to the end of his days. So the final one is the story of Mahajanaka. And that Devi Manimakkala also figures in this one. She appears also in this one. This begins with a king named Mahajanaka, a king in Wadehi, and he had two sons, Aritajanaka and Polajanaka. And when he died, the elder son, Aritajanaka, became king after him, and the younger son, Polajanaka, was made a viceroy and captain of the armies. But there was various palace intrigues going on, and one of the scheming courtiers wanted to get rid of Polajanaka, and he started a whispering campaign that false charges against the younger son, Polajanaka, that he was scheming against the king. So the king had him thrown in prison. put in irons and thrown in prison. And he escaped from there and vowed he would take his vengeance. He said, "I was not the enemy of my brother before, but I am now." And he came back later with an army that he'd raised, and they fought a tremendous battle, and the king, Aritaka, was killed in the battle, and so his brother Polajanika took the throne. The wife of the first king, Aritajanika, the elder brother, she escaped in disguise. She disguised herself as a peasant woman and in dirty clothes and ragged scarf over her head to hide her hair and her features. And she escaped outside the city gates. And she had lived a sheltered life in the palace, and she didn't really know where she ought to go, who she ought to seek out for help. But she'd heard her husband talk about the town of Kalachampa as being a very pleasant town, so that's the only thing was in her mind to try to get to Kalachampa. She sat down beside the road and asked passers-by, "Is anyone going to Kalachampa? Is anyone going to Kalachampa?" Now, Saka was in his heaven, and he felt his throne tremble. He knew there was some trouble on earth, and he saw this with his divine eye. He searched out this queen, and he saw that she was pregnant with a holy being. This was the Bodhisatta. He was born from this queen. And so he says, Saka said, "I'm going to save this queen from her distress." As he often did when he visited Earth, he took on the form of a raggedy, disreputable-looking old Brahmin, and was driving a cart. And he came by, and she says, "Are you going to Kalachampa?" And he said, "Well, as it happens, so I am. Get in my cart, dear lady." And she said, "Oh, I'm heavy with child. I can't climb up into that cart." And he said, "Don't worry. Just climb up to it. I know what I'm doing." And as she tried to climb into the cart, the earth rose up so that it was level with the back of the cart. She easily stepped in. And he said, "Go to sleep, dear, and rest, and we'll take you to Kalachampa." And when she opened her eyes, they were pulling into the city gates of Kalachampa. And she said, "I've always heard this place was a very great distance away, 60 yojanas or so. How did we get here so quickly?" And he said, "I know a straight road." So she entered the city, and he disappeared. That's the end of Saka in the story. And she entered the city, and she was adopted by a Brahmin family, and the elderly husband had it put out that she was his sister. And they took care of her and her son, the Brahmin and his wife. They took care of her, and when her boy was born, they took care of the boy. And the boy, who took the name of his grandfather, Mahajanaka, he was, of course, the Bodhisatta, and he was the rightful heir to the throne. The other boys, the other village boys, harassed him and bullied him and called him names because his mother apparently had no husband, so he was without caste. It was like a disgrace to be, you know, without caste. And so he asked his mother, "Who's my father?" And she didn't want to tell him, but eventually he got it out of her. And he determined from that day on, when he grew up, he'd get his kingdom back. And when he came to manhood, he said he was going to head out and take his kingdom. And the queen said, "Well, I have a good fortune of money that I took away with me, hidden in my basket from the kingdom. You can have the whole thing and take all my wealth and use it to make your way back." And he said, "I wouldn't take all your money, mother. Just give me half, and then I'll trade in Suwanabhumi and make up the rest." So he headed to the port with these gold and jewels and took on board a ship. And as usual with these ill-fated ventures, it sprung a leak and went down in mid-ocean. And just like in the previous story, he saved himself from the shipwreck by covering himself in ghee. And in this case, it said that as the ship was going down, carnivorous fish were attacking the sailors, and the whole sea around was red with blood. And he climbed up to the mast as the ship sunk. He was above the water on the mast, and he sprung into the air and made a mighty leap. And he leapt over all this area of the fish and hit the water and just started swimming. And again, we have our friend Mani Makala, the Dewa. She was playing about again and missed this poor guy in the ocean 7 days. And when she found him, he was almost at the end of his strength. And she picked him out of the water and cradled him on her breast to fly back to India, to Jambudvipa. And it said that he thrilled at the divine touch, he swooned, which is something that comes up in a few of the stories, that a human being touched by a dewa, a physical contact with a dewa, causes this effusion of pleasure so strong that they swoon, they lose consciousness. And she flew him back to India and left him on a flat rock outside the gates of the town where he had been king. Now, in the meanwhile, in the kingdom, the old king, his uncle, Polajanaka, had died, and he died without an heir. So there was distress in the kingdom. Who are we going to give the throne to? And he had a daughter, Siwala Devi, who was very wise and beautiful and proud. And the old king, before he died, he had said, "You must test anyone who wants to take the throne. You must test them first. They must please my daughter, Sula Devi, if they're going to marry her, and she'll be the consort. They must please her. Second, they have to show their cleverness. They have to be able to say which side of a square bed is the head. Third, they have to show their strength. There's a bow in the storeroom that it takes 1,000 men to pull the bow. And if he can pull the bow, then he's strong enough. And finally, he has to solve the riddle of hidden treasure. I've hidden treasure in the place of the setting sun, in the place of the rising sun, on the inside, on the outside, in the middle, and under the four sal posts." Sal is a kind of a tree. So all the various nobles of the kingdom were, put to the test, beginning with the commander of the armies. And first thing was they had to go see Sula Devi, the princess. And she saw this commander of the army. She didn't think too much of him. And she told him, "Okay, run around the courtyard. I want to see how well you can run." And then after he'd run around the courtyard a few times, she says, "Come here and rub my feet." And so he got down to rub her feet, and she kicked him in the head and knocked him over and said, "Get away, you fool." And she treated all the other nobles in the same way. Nobody could please her. And none of them could pull the bowstring, and none of them could solve the riddles. So now they were in a real quandary, and they felt they absolutely had to find somebody to be king. So they performed a magical ritual. They took a royal chariot, and with nobody in it, they put it like a set it up with like a palanquin with cloths over it and banners and a herald walking behind, and just let the horses go in whichever direction they chose, and said wherever these horses stop, there will be the rightful king. And the horses wandered all around the town, then out the town gates and down the road, and they came to this rock where Mahajanaka was lying still asleep. And he woke up when he heard the noise of the carts coming, and he guessed what was happening from his knowledge of royal ritual. And he turned his back to them so that his soles of his feet were exposed. And the Brahmins in the retinue recognized by the marks on his feet that he was of the royal blood. and they took him back to the kingdom, and he sat on the throne. They took him into the throne room, and he sat on the throne, and he started immediately giving orders and determining changes he wanted made to the palace. And he had the royal architect in and was discussing with him. And that this princess, Silawa Dewi, she heard this was going on, and this fellow had arrived. So she said, "Oh, I have to put him to the test." And she told one of the serving girls, "Go and tell him to come and see me immediately, that I've summoned him to be interviewed immediately." And she goes into the royal chambers, and she makes her announcement that Princess Silawa Dewi wishes to see the new king immediately. And he just ignores her, brushes her away, goes on talking about the architectural stuff. And this happens 3 times. And then when he's finished all his business, he gets up and walks at a leisurely pace towards the place where Silawa Dewi is, and then in her rooms in the palace. And he's climbing up the steps, and she sees him coming, and she's so overcome by his lordly bearing that she reaches out a hand to help him up on the last step. And then all the courtiers are gathered around now, and they say, "Well, sir, before you can actually be crowned as king, we need to determine you have to pass these tests." "And what are the tests?" "Well, first you have to please the princess." "Well, obviously I pleased her. She gave me her hand of her own will." "So, okay, you passed the first test. Now, the second test is, can you determine which end of a square bed is the head?" And he took a gold needle out of his hair, a gold pin out of his hair, and he gave it to the princess, and he said, "Put that on the head of the bed." And she went and put it on the bed. He said, "That ends the head." So that was okay, that's good enough. And they got the bow out, and he pulled it easily. And then he found all the treasures, the place of the setting sun and the rising sun. Everyone else had tried digging and searching in the east and the west. He said, "Did the old king ever give alms to Pacheco Buddhas?" He said, "Yes." "And where did they come when they flew in?" Because they always traveled by flying. "When they flew in to receive their alms, where did they land?" "Well, that's the place of the setting sun. The sun represents the Pacheco Buddha. And where did they rise up again? That's the place of the rising sun." So he went and dug in those places, and there was gold there, bags of gold. And then inside, outside, in the middle, that was easy enough. He went to the main gate of the palace, and just outside the gate, just inside the gate, and right in the threshold in the middle. And finally, the 4 cell posts, everyone else had been digging up around cell trees and cutting down trees, and he saw that there was an ornamental table in the throne room that had 4 posts. The legs were posts made out of cell wood, and he had them taken off and examined, and they were hollow, and they were filled with diamonds. So he'd found all the treasure and passed all the tests, and he became the king and married Silawa Dewi. And they lived for a long time. At that time, human lifespan was 10,000 years. And after he'd been on the throne for 7,000 years, one time he was leaving on a jaunt on his royal elephant, leaving the palace grounds. There was a couple of mango trees, a pair of mango trees, and they were just coming into ripeness, and he plucked one mango from the tree and tasted it, and it was so delicious. And he said, "I'll have to have more when I come back." And the other people who lived in the palace, they thought the etiquette was not to eat from the mango trees until the king had had the first fruit. So now he'd taken one fruit from that tree, so now they felt that they could take fruit from that tree. And the whole big crowd of people, courtiers and workmen and everybody else, and the harem girls and everybody else, were crowding around the tree and beating it with sticks to knock the mangoes down, and it damaged all the branches and knocked the leaves about, and the tree was a mess. And when the king came back, the one tree was a mess and the other one was pristine. And he said, "How'd this happen?" And they told him, "Well, because you had taken one fruit, so people felt justified in taking more." And he thought, "This is a lesson to me. the fruits of sense pleasures and royal delight is leading me nowhere, it's just to ruin. And he made a determination to become an ascetic. And when he left the palace, his queen, Suladevi, didn't want him to go. And she begged him and implored him, and he refused to listen. He just headed down the road, and she ended up following behind him. And everywhere he went, she followed behind, always trying to begging him to come back. And he had a hard time getting rid of her. And they come to a village, and there was a young girl in the marketplace selling stuff out of a basket. She was wearing, on one wrist, she was wearing a jeweled wristband, and a jangly bang, what do you call it?
Bangle.
A bangle. And she had two on the other arm. And when she moved her arms, the arm that had two would make a jingly noise, and the other arm was silent. And he said to his queen, you see, two together makes a noise. One alone is peaceful. And she still didn't take the hint. And they came a little further in the market. There was a guy selling in arrows. He was making and selling arrows, a fletcher. And when he had the shaft of an arrow, he was checking it out. He would hold it up and close one eye and peer down the end of the shaft. And he says, you see, one eye closed, he sees more clearly. Two open, he's just confused. So, you know, this went on for some time. And then in the end, he just waited till she was asleep, and he snuck off into the woods and disappeared and left her. So then he lived for the rest of his days as a hermit in the forest, and he attained to all the jhanas and the psychic powers. So that's four stories involving sea voyages and shipwrecks.